Let's go to the word of the day. Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1. Reading from the NASB. Let us turn in our Bibles to our lesson for the day. A tremendous gift of God that we know that we are saved, not by our own merit and our own doing. We are saved from the wrath of God by His very Son, by His blood. We have been covered and we are now saved. For those that believe in the gospel of Jesus Christ, praise God for that. Romans chapter 1, we're going to start our reading in verse number 28. And it reads as follows. And just as they did not see fit to acknowledge God any longer, God gave them over to a depraved mind to do those things which are not proper, being filled with all unrighteousness, wickedness, greed, evil, full of envy, murder and strife, deceit, malice. They are gossips, slanderers, haters of God and insolent, arrogant and boastful. They're inventors of evil. They're disobedient to parents. They're without understanding. They are untrustworthy, unloving, unmerciful. And although they know the ordinance of God, that those who practice such things are worthy of death, they not only do the same, but also give hearty approval to those who practice them. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, the mirror of truth is before our faces. In your word, your perfect and inerrant word, we are able to see ourselves. We're able to see what you see. Lord, we thank you that we are able to see the good news, a solution to this list of sin that fills humanity. Through the gospel of Jesus Christ, the gospel that Paul says he is not ashamed of, the power of the gospel makes us new. We are no longer children of disobedience for those that believe. We are now children of God. And although sometimes this list of 21 disgraceful sins creep into our lives from time to time, we are thankful it does not define who we are. As you touch our hearts, encourage us, Almighty God, through your Spirit. Show us, those that believe, show us that this is what we used to be. And remind us what we're going to be. Because we know you're not finished with us yet. Work your word into our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I know some of you are looking at me saying, is he finally done with chapter 1 of Romans? I'm here to say we're not going to be finished with chapter 1 yet. Amen. This is a hard hitting, human being describing chapter. This tells us who we once were before the gospel of Jesus Christ entered our hearts. We look at this list, and the humble Christian will look at this list and say, oh, what Christ saved me from. Others will look at this list and think that they no longer have these traits in them. But we will see what the Word says. Amen? We come to the end of chapter 1. We are now thrusted into the natural man. What man without Christ is not only capable of, but what man without Christ is. These sins define who the natural man is. It spells out a total depravity of humanity. It's a sad state of affairs in which there is no way out of total depravity but by the good news of Jesus Christ. We have seen and we have read over the last couple of weeks that the fall of man is into hopelessness. It began as man failed to recognize God as God. Man began to fall. We see in verse 21, it led to trying to redirect the plan of God and God's creation by making or reinventing the God that we know and replacing him with idol worship, which led to unseemingly things. When this occurred, Paul reminds us that in verse 24, that God gave humanity up to their lusts. You want other gods? I'll give you other gods. Man slips further into sin. Verse 24, God gives them up to their lusts, and then the spiral downward continues when sexual fornication becomes the main frame of humanity's mindset, degrading one another's bodies. Women with women, men with men, lewd acts of sexual immorality. Verse 26 says, for that reason, God gave them up once again, which spiraled into degrading passions. The downward spiral continues from there. Idol worship is the beginning of God taking his hands off of humanity, and then it's sexual fornication and immorality. The last step, they slip into total unrighteousness. They slip into total depravity. And we come to verse 28. This is today the sad state of humanity all over the world. And just as they did not see fit to acknowledge God any longer, God gave them over to a depraved mind, to do the things which are not proper. Today's focus is on the sinful heart. We can see from God's eyes that through the pen of Paul, the natural man and the sin that has engulfed the man's heart is never ending. Man cannot help themselves. They are who they are. We look at humanity today. We see the hopelessness around us when we turn on the news and open up newspapers. In this year alone, so far there has been 83 mass shootings in America. There has been 19,677 total number of incidents from gun violence alone. We look at the world and the state today and we can't understand. We even reach out and question God, how can you do or let such events happen? But humanity has progressed to this level. But for Jesus Christ. As horrific as it is, it still shocks us. We have great economic times right now. There's so much going on. There's so many resources. We have so much information. We have so many people professing to be Christians in this country. Why is there so much violence? The answer always comes back. The answer is not in our society. The answer is in the Word of God. Why, when we are so prosperous, why, when so many individuals are leaving their countries, dying to get here, why is this place so violent? Why is this country so in need? Why is this such a hard place to be? Verse 29 begins to tell us the story. He begins by saying that because of the things that have been done by humanity, God has given them over to their desires, and with those desires, the end of verse 28 says, that humanity will do those things which are not proper. Not proper to who? Not proper in the sight of God. What are those things? The sinner aspires to do the things that God does not approve of. Those that have not been saved in the blood of Christ desires to do the things that God does not approve of. Because that's all they know. There is no choice in them. Paul starts a list that is just devastating. He begins by saying, being filled with all unrighteousness. The word for to be filled with, the word to describe that phrase, being filled with all unrighteousness, being filled, is a Greek verb, pleroho. Pleroho is a word that means to be or become containing as much of or as much as possible to what is normal. They're not filled with some unrighteousness. The unsaved individual is not filled with some unrighteousness. Unrighteousness is in the heart of the non-believer to the point where it overflows. There's no more unrighteousness that they can contain in themselves. It spills over. And it's a constant, it's a verb, it's a constant filling over of unrighteousness. They don't get better. They continue to get worse. And when they feel empty of unrighteousness, they crave more unrighteousness. Sinner is actively being filled with these constant sins that rule and dictate their lives. Some of us remember those days, amen? If we're honest, we call that the BC days. You know, before Christ, amen? Some of us are still living those days because we're still in the BC days. But for those that have given their life to Christ through the gospel of Jesus Christ, we can remember these days. It's a constant filling. There is no control over the fact that the non-believer is constantly being filled with unacceptable behavior in the sight of God. All unrighteousness. The heart of the human being has a never-ending fill of these ungodly acts and attitudes. It's no wonder that society will always be doomed without God. Question should not be, how does God allow it? The question should be, how is it not worse? Amen? I'll give you a little insight. Paul writes a letter to Thessalonica, a church that he started during one of his missionary tours. Let us turn to 2 Thessalonians. Why is it that this society isn't completely and utterly gone? Why isn't this world completely and utterly gone? Looking at chapter 2 of 2 Thessalonians, we have the answer. The answer is the Holy Spirit in the life of the believers. The answer is the church where the Holy Spirit dwells. Paul is preparing the church that is going through a lot of suffering. Preparing the church that an apostasy is coming. That people are creeping into the church. Wolves in sheep's clothing to try their best to move God out of the picture. And he gives them this word of warning. Chapter 2, verse 1, "Now we request you, brethren, with regard to the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our gathering together to him, that you not be quickly shaken from your composure, or be disturbed either by a spirit or a message or of a letter as if from us, to the effect that the day of the Lord has come." They were getting an idea that the last days were in effect, that Jesus was there, Jesus had come, and they got this letter or this message from liars, from wolves in sheep's clothing, and it bothered them. They were wondering, did we miss the rapture? They were wondering if they didn't understand what the gospel was all about. And Paul's encouraging them, saying there's going to be liars in the church. They're not from God, they're from Satan. He says, let no one in any way deceive you. Don't be deceived by the words that do not come from God. For it will not come unless the apostasy comes first. The last days, the returning of Jesus Christ will not come until there's a great falling away from the church. There's going to be people that claim to be Christians and they're going to leave the church because times get tough. They're going to walk away. They're not going to really be believers. They're going to be people in church, but the church is not in the people. Amen. They're going to be participators on Sundays in a building, but Christ does not live in them. They're not part of the church. They're just inside of a church. They're going to fall away because times get tough. That's the great apostasy. That is the apostasy that comes. When that happens, the man of lawlessness is revealed. When that happens, the Antichrist will come, the son of destruction. That has not happened yet. the son of destruction who opposes and exalts himself above every so-called God or object of worship. He's an idol. He wants to be worshipped. And many will worship him. We know that in the end time. So that he takes his seat in the temple of God. He will be sitting in the temple in Jerusalem, displaying himself as being God. He's going to sit there on the throne as if he were God. Do you not remember that while I was still with you, I was telling you these things? He said, don't worry, I already talked about this. Don't worry about what other people are saying. We get caught up in that sometimes, don't we? Instead of being secure in the Word, we start listening to a whole bunch of soothsayers about when Jesus is coming. When the Bible clearly says we don't know the time. Amen? Amen. But somebody always figures it out. And they're always adjusting and amending their coming of Christ because that day comes and goes. And then they're, oh, I forgot to add this day and these weeks and this month. The truth is, we don't know. Amen? Verse 6 and 7 is the answer to why this society that we live in, why this world that we live in isn't worse than it should be. Verse 6, and you know that, you know what restrains him now, what keeps Satan from utterly destroying everything. Now, so that it is in his time he will be revealed. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. We can see sin abounding. We can already see his work abounding on earth. Why isn't it broken loose yet? Only he who now restrains. Who is he? He is the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit restrains it from happening today. When the unbeliever is filled with these things in Romans chapter 1. Why is it that this world hasn't fallen apart yet? Because the Holy Spirit has been restraining it. When will it end? Only he who now restrains will do so until he will restrain evil and sin until he is taken out of the way, when the Holy Spirit is removed from this world. When is this Holy Spirit removed out of this world? When we are removed out of this world. Amen? I say we, I say the believer. Does the Holy Spirit not live in us? Let us go back to Romans study. Going back to verse number 29. One day, the Holy Spirit is removed from this world. This list from verse 29 through verse number 31 will be the demise of this world. When all godliness is removed from an ungodly world, that's when this world will implode. A lot of people believe that the church is here to make the world better. Amen? So they say, get up, Christian, and do your job, and let's make more Christians. And as we make more Christians, then more hearts will change. And as more hearts change, the world gets better. That's not what is happening. God is calling his people out of this world to come to Christ. And as he's calling us out of this world to come to Christ, when the last one is called, then he pulls everybody out. Do you remember the story of Noah and the ark? Isn't it amazing only a very few got in the ark and millions perished? Are you in the ark? Christ Jesus is our ark. See, the wrath of God came down upon the world. And only those that were in the ark, only us that are in Christ will be saved from the wrath of God. But you have to be in Christ. Not next to the ark, not on the outside of the ark, not holding on for dear life. You need to be in Christ, not next to Him. And more importantly, He needs to be in you. The world does not know this. The world does not have this. The world is lost. Many scholars, as we look at verse number 29, many scholars place these sins in groupings, in categories. We're not going to do that today. We're going to go over some of them, and as we look at ourselves, you know, we can actually see some of these things still occurring in our lives. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
So we still revert back to our sin nature sometimes. Amen?
Amen.
Too many people walk around, and once they come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, they put their chest out as though they're untouchable. I tell the men's brotherhood on Saturday, some of us are so heavenly minded that we're of no earthly use. We're so high on ourselves because of our salvation, we have to look down to see God. But if we're honest, sometimes we act like and look like and do the things that Jesus Christ saved us from. Amen? He begins with wickedness. He says, we're filled with all unrighteousness. And he begins by saying wickedness. And what is wickedness? It's the aptness, the ability to do shrewd turns, to delight in mischief and tragedies, a loving to trouble one's neighbor and do him ill offices. It is a desire to see bad upon other people. This is exactly why Satan is called the Wicked One. He is the author of wickedness. He wants everybody to perish. He wants everybody to fail because he has fallen. Without Christ, the natural man has wickedness fill him up. He loves bad things happening to other people. Paionexia is covetousness, it's greediness, the next one on the list. Paionexia, Greek word, means the desire for more and more, and it's insatiable desire. You can't get enough. It is much more than saying I love money or the love of money that we see later in the Word of God. Covetousness has a wider and a deeper sense to it. It's designating the sinful desire which goes out after things of time and sense of every form of kind. Hence, it is defined by Paul as idolatry in Colossians chapter 3, verse 5. It's idolatry. It's being filled with all idolatry. Anything that takes your mind and heart away from God is idolatry. It's a worship of another object that, other than God. It is so often associated with fleshly sins. We see it in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 11. We see it in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 3 and 5. We see it in Colossians 3 and 5. It is putting your attentions on things that are not God. We always say, well, you know, I love God with all my heart, soul, and mind because I am commanded to. But do we really? Do we really? Are we like that dog that you say, sit and stay, and then as soon as something runs by, as soon as a rabbit runs by, or a squirrel, God says, follow me, look at me, keep your eyes on me. And we say, yes, Lord, we love you, Lord, we need you, Lord, we can't have enough of him. What is that? Huh. A new car. I wonder where they got that. Can't afford that, can they? Right? Wickedness creeps in, you know. They can't fix up their yard, but they can drive a car like that. Why don't they put their priorities together? In the old Baptist church, if it didn't hit close to home, you say amen. But if it hits close to home, say ouch. These are the things that creep back up into our lives, isn't it? But because of Jesus Christ, as they creep in our life, there's a battle that now takes place. The old man that we used to be is now fighting against the new man created in Christ. If that battle does not take place, you better check to make sure you're in the faith. Here's an interesting set after this. Evil is the next one on the list. Kakia. Kakia is Greek. This is perversion. Depravity. A depraved mind. Perversion. Perverting of virtue and moral principles from their purpose to evil ends. It's malice in some of your Bibles. It's maliciousness. We still have some of that in our members. I'm not saying the members of the church, I'm saying in our own bodies. Malice. Let's look at James chapter 1. See, the reason why we're talking about these things is because they still occur in our life. We must fight with the spirit that indwells us. In James chapter 1, James writes this letter and he says these things in verse 21. Let's go to verse number 19. This is where it actually really focuses in. This is testing our faith. To see if you're in Christ. Amen? Verse 19 of chapter 1, he says, this you know, my beloved brother. And he's talking about believers. Okay? And he says, this you know, because this is what you've been taught. He says these things. This you know, my beloved brethren. But everyone must be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. We're quick to speak. We're quick to anger, and we're slow to hear. He says it has to be the opposite. Amen? For the anger of man does not achieve the righteousness of God. So slow your roll as believers. Amen? When they give you fries out of the drive-thru, and they don't give you the large, they give you the small, don't pull around. Y'all hold on, I only got about 5 minutes. I thought for sure somebody would say ouch. Maybe I should say it.
Ouch.
Ouch.
What about the fries?
Here we go. He says it does not achieve the righteousness of God. Verse 21, therefore, because of this, we have a choice. Therefore, Because it does not achieve the righteousness of God, do something else. What is the other? What is something else? Why is he having to talk to the church? Because we have this in our flesh. We don't come to Christ and say, well, 21 things off the list of Romans is now gone. Oh, it's still there. When I said I still had 5 more minutes, some of you guys were malicious. Look, verse 21, therefore, putting aside all filthiness. You see that? We have a choice now. When Christ comes into our life, we have a choice. Do we serve God or do we serve the list in verse 21? Or the 21 sins in the list that we're going through. We have a choice. And God doesn't make the choice for us. That's called our free will. We have to work. We have to live. We have to grow. And we have to be obedient. He says, therefore, put aside all, not most, not the stuff you like or the stuff that you can do without, all of it. Yeah, I see that, right? Maybe it's my part. All filthiness and all that remains of wickedness. You see that? Now, he doesn't say put it aside to where you can easily grab it when you need it. That's not what he means. He means do away with it. He means don't have it in your life anymore. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Because remember times when we were going to church. That's when Satan shows up the most, when you go to praise God, right? We're going to church and it was in central El Paso and where it's early and we're driving to church and somebody might cut off my mother and she says, oh, they're going to have me put down my Christianity. Amen? Some of us think that but don't say it. At least she was able to say it.
Ouch.
She'd say, I have a choice. Amen, brother. I have a choice, but my choice is to put on this list. Know what I'm saying? All that remains of wickedness, in humility, with a humble heart, in humility, receive the word implanted. Don't do what you feel, do what he says. And then you'll avoid the list of 21 sins. Why do we listen to the word that's implanted in us? Because it was able to save our souls. So if we are saved in Christ and our soul is saved, why do we still want to live like the natural man? When we have a God, the creator of all things. Why do we want to put down our Christianity when we remember what it used to be without Christianity? Amen? But we forget that. So we have to be reminded of that. This is why he says that. The word that was implanted. The word that was implanted in us is still in us. This is why we're able to say, we know we're going to sin even before we sin, don't we? Ouch. Some of us will even say, I know I shouldn't be doing this. Let's go on to the list. Let's go back to Romans. The next on the list is envy. Now, come on. It's hard not to be envious when we're on social media all day looking at what everybody has and wanting it, right? There's only one solution. Stop looking at it. Envy is spite or jealousy for what others have or are doing. And Paul warns the believer in Galatians chapter 5 not to participate in these activities in our spiritual life. We just read where he talked about it, or where James talked about it. Now Paul talks about it in Galatians 5, chapter 5, verse 21. He says, envying and drunkenness, carousing, and things like these, of which I forewarned you. Just as I have forewarned you that those who participate such things or practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. He says, stop practicing these things because the people that practice these things will not be in the kingdom of heaven. They will not inherit the kingdom of heaven. So why are you doing it? Paul says. Man has no other choice but to live this way. But believers in Christ have a choice. So do we hate those that do these things? Do we hate one another for doing these things? The next one on the list is murderers. Phonos. What are murderers? When you hate somebody, you've just committed murder. Are the air conditioners too loud? When you hate someone, you have committed murder in the eyes of God. Well, that's just, you know, that's general. I haven't killed anybody. 1 John chapter 3, verse 15. Everyone who hates his brother is a murderer.
Ouch.
That's the word. That's not opinion. That's true. Everyone. Not most of us. Not some of us. Doesn't depend on who the person is. Everyone who hates his brother is a murderer. And you know that no murderer has eternal life abiding in him. That's what is in 1 John. 1 John chapter 3, verse 15. Everyone who hates his brother is a murderer. This is why we need Jesus, y'all. So when we fall into these things, when we go back to what we used to do, when we have sin in our flesh overtaking us, it covers us. Amen? So we don't walk around proud. We walk around with repentance on our heart. And the last one that we're going to cover today is strife. Some of your Bibles say debate. Some people just like to have disagreements with another person.
Ouch.
It's the act of having bitter disagreements. Why? Just because. You say blue, I say green. You say go, I say stop. Why? Just because. Now, I know you guys are looking at your spouse and looking at... Why? In the French, it's called departir, which means to beat down. To break the spirit up, to beat down somebody. Because you can. The world does it all the time. Amen. You know what's amazing about that? God says encourage one another. Lift one another up. Because the world is going to beat them down. The natural man is going to beat down anything he can. But he says to brothers and sisters, the Lord says to his children, pull each other up. Amen. Because the world is going to hate them. They're going to beat them down. You need to hold each other up. Yes. Encourage one another. Amen. Amen? Yes. This is strife. This is debate. Why is this so important that we read this as believers? We read this as believers because we're reminded of what we used to be before Christ, and we're also reminded that we still have these tendencies in our life. And if we do not keep ourselves in check, if we do not choose Christ, we'll fall back to what we used to do. We call that backsliding in the church. Amen? We call that a stronghold in our life. But not only does Jesus save us, he keeps us. And when we choose Christ, he leads us out of this foolishness that we were in. He'll break this hold on us. The more we look up and not look out, the stronger we get. Amen? There was only one window on the ark, and it was always looking up. We always look toward Christ. As we continue to develop this, I don't say to anybody, don't worry about this list. Jesus paid it all. We still have to worry about this list day by day, moment by moment.
Amen.
Because we have a choice. Are we going to choose us, the old nature, or are we going to choose Christ, the new man in us? Of us today are going through some things. And in those things, we are suffering on the inside. We are dealing with more of this list than we want to really talk about. And because of it, we need to get back into the fellowship of Christ for those that believe. We see what we are. We know what we are. And when we're alone and the lights are off and it's just God and ourselves, and when we have this conversation, we know what we are and what we've done. But when we come to him with a humble heart, he says, I know what you've done. I knew what you were going to do before you did it. I love you anyway. I love you anyway. Because that was this stripe that I got on my back. That sin was this that I counted upon myself. We forget that. Paul says, I am not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because it is the power of God unto salvation from his wrath. It is a power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes. First the Jew, and then the Gentile. We can't forget that. That's the good news. Before we serve the Lord's Supper, I'm going to do something that we rarely do. I truly believe that there are some suffering among us that need to be encouraged through prayer. Now, we're about to partake in the remembrance of what Jesus Christ did for us, and some of us are thinking and beating ourselves up for what we haven't been doing. Some of us don't even know how to pray anymore. Some of us need to be encouraged. Some of us are starting new jobs. Some of us are having difficulty with our kids. Some of us are having difficulty with our finances. Our minds are all over the place. Let's put our minds back on Christ and let him handle the rest. This is the case. Let us pray together as a fellowship, as a church fellowship. Let us come to Christ together as a unit, as a family, and let us pray one for another. I don't think there's a more fitting way to check our hearts before taking communion. Amen. If there's something in your mind, something in your heart, something that you're wrestling with, if it's sin, if it's anger, if it's sadness, if it's depression, if it's anxiety, if it's stress, whatever it is, bring it to the Lord. And let Him be God. Amen? Don't worry about who's watching. Don't worry about what they might think of you. It doesn't matter. Only matters what God thinks. And if He's opened up the door for us, why don't we walk through it? Let's walk through it together. One for another. If you want prayer, if you desire to come up for prayer, let's do it. As the music plays, if you don't want to get up, if you want to just sit there and pray, that's good too. But pray. I know some of you aren't used to this because it's too close to somebody else. Come to the Lord and see Him do what He does.